Application. So type checking is very important thing. You will you already know, right? In the C, Java, like even in Python also, if you try to multiply two variables which are of not same type, then it will give you type error, right? Say you have say char C and you have int A and B, okay, and somebody is trying to do A equal to C multiplication B. What will happen? You will get an error that this C and B are not of same type. From where this error comes? It is not a runtime error. It is a compile time error. During compilation, you will get this error, right? And it will come from the part of type checking. When the type checking will go on, it will see whether this operation, right, multiplication operation supported between the type of C and type of B. That means type of, it will see it like this. Char multiplication int, right? Whether this is supported by the language, and it will say, oh no, this char multiplication int is not supported, then it will provide you, it will give you error. Understand? It will generate some error. So use this logical rule to reason about the behavior of a program at runtime, specifically to ensure that the types of the operand match the type expected by the operator. For example, the ampersand operator in Java expects its two operand to be Boolean. Okay, the result is also of type Boolean. So yeah, so in this case, it is in this such cases, it is definitely happens during runtime. You can see it is written here at runtime, right? But what example I was giving, this kind of error can be detected in the compilation time itself. Okay, then translation application from the type of right, a compiler can determine the storage that will be needed for the name at runtime. So type information is also needed to calculate the address denoted by an array reference, to insert explicit type conversions, and to choose the right version of an arithmetic operator, among other things. So to choose the right version of the arithmetic operation, because in Java, you can understand there is a polymorphism, okay? Same arithmetic operation can do different kind of operation. Even if you are doing simply a multiplication between a float and int, this is allowed. But what is the algorithm for multiplying float into int? And if you have int into int, int multiplication int, they are not same. Float into int will be happened using some algorithm, and int into int will happen using some other algorithm. So there is different version of this multiplication, correct? So this is the thing is there. Then type expression, like if you see here, int 2, 3, that means it is saying that two-dimensional array is there, which is having two rows and three columns. It is basically array of two arrays, which two arrays are basically having three elements and which are integer. Okay, so it can be given by a syntax tree, like array 2, 3 are the size, and this is the type, and this type is going to be carried out int arrows int. Okay, so the basic type, a basic type is a type expression. Understand? So what is a type expression? It is a basic type. Then a type name is a type expression. So if there is a type name, like integer is a type name, integer, right? So that is a type expression. A type expression can be formed by applying the array type constructor to a number and a type of expression. Okay. So a record is data structure with named field. So a type expression can be formed by using the type constructor for function types. And if S and T are type expression, then their Cartesian product S multiplication T is also a type expression. That means different combination between S and T, you can understand, right? Then type expression may contain variables whose values are type expressions again, okay? So this is we understand. Next comes type equivalence. So type equivalence, we already have some idea, right? So they are the same basic type, like double and plot. You may have double variable, double type, and you may have float type. So they are quite equivalent. The only thing is that the length is different, right? So they are formed by applying same constructor to structurally equivalent type. One is a type name that denotes the other. Okay, so here the declaration is like this. You can see grammar rules is there, D to TID, and this T gives you different type. Basically later you will find which is B and C is there, or record D. Okay, so if I go with this D, T, then ID, right? Then this T can give us what? B and C. So, and this B can give us, say, int, right? And this C can give us epsilon. Now you read. It is int epsilon ID. That means it is int ID. ID means what? Identifier. This can be some identifier or some variable name A. So basically it validates us some expression like int A, right? So this is the thing, how declare things are declared in for type expression. Okay, now storage layout for local names. So you can see it is there, width of each type. So it is plot type. So with this 8-bit is defined, type integer with is given here. Okay, and when you are doing array, so what will happen? Number of element into the width. You can see the number of element into width is happening. So all these things are there, how the programming language works, what kind of programmer are put it behind it. Okay, so that the programming languages can calculate that how much memory, how much memory is need to be assigned to some array, to some variable and everything, right? So based on this kind of grammar and semantic rules, okay? Now, storage layout for local names, you can see here, I'm not again discussing, it will take huge time because this is a quite big chapter. So you understand, right? We have discussed a lot about this dependency and attributes and all. You can see this array, this type integer is going through this. Okay, so the whole array becomes integer type. Okay, then translation of expression and statements. We discussed how to find the type and offset of the variables. We have therefore necessary preparations to discuss about translation and intermediate code. We also discussed the type checking, right? We have already checked done all this thing. Then triadic code for expression. Okay, so if some expression is given, then how we can develop a triadic code that is there. Then okay, incremental translation, address array element. Okay, address of array element, we know all this. Because if there is 2D array, right, so it happens, in reality, the array is going to be, array is actually stored into 1D, but we can, access them like this, I comma J, right? So this is the thing, you know, representation. We already know all these things, right? This is another. Then semantic action for array reference. Translation of array references, like, you know, L dot address, L dot array, and L dot type, all these things. We understand, right? So annotated parse tree for C plus A, and here you can see A is an array. So how the parse tree will look like? You can see, basically, this part is for A, I, J, okay? And this part is definitely for C, okay? So this is doing the parse. So I'm not going into all these complex things right now. Here, this is very familiar thing to us. You can see here, type checking conversion between primitive types in Java, okay? So T1 plot 2. So this is one example. You can see, very interesting, okay? So T1 is a temporary variable. So when we are going to, you know, we try to multiply integer into float, what happens? So this integer is basically value is 2. Then we do what? In the background, what it happens? It does calculate first, you know, generate a temporary variable T1, typecast this 2 to floating type. Okay, so now this T1 is become a float. Now T1, and we have already say here 3.14, which is float. Okay, so it is also float. So float into float, it gives a float result. This, now we know this widening conversion and narrowing conversion. So here you can see you have double float. This is the hierarchy, right? Long, int, short, char, byte. So if you go in this direction, the conversion is going to be widened. And if you come in this direction, it is going to be narrowing. So it is going to truncate a few bit every time if you convert your variable from double to float. So, you know, by default, internal conversion technique, right, does not support this narrowing thing, but widening things can happen automatically, right? So this is called implicit and explicit. So implicitly, all these things happens in programming languages, many programming languages. But this thing, if you want, you have to do it using explicit conversion. Understand? Then introducing the type conversion into expression evaluation. So you can see here, the semantic rules are given here. So I'm not going into all these things, okay? Unification, algorithm for unification.